Okay, good morning. Today I will discuss with you property and other real rights. So there is a difference between property and other real rights. And today we will see the difference between property and ownership, possession, servitude, habitation, superficies, and usufruct. These are the six real rights that you can find in Thailand. Let's start with ownership. What is ownership? What is the difference between ownership and property? Ownership is the right of ownership. I am the owner of my car. Car is the property. Ownership is the real right that the owner has over the property. So you can say, I am the owner of a car. I am the owner of a house. I am the owner of a phone. House, car, phones, these are all examples of different types of properties. So let's see how the law defines ownership. Ownership gives the owner the right to use, dispose, and enjoy the fruits of the property. Use, dispose, and enjoy the fruits. What is the right to use? The right to use is, for example, you can, if you are the owner of a land, you can use the land for agricultural purposes, for commercial purposes, to open a resort, or as a residential purpose, to build a house and to live there. You can dispose of the ownership of the property you have, which means you can, for example, sell the house, you can rent the house, or you can donate the house as a gift. You can also enjoy the fruits of the land. You can enjoy the fruits of the land, which means you can grow rice, or you can have a plantation of trees. You can grow vegetables if you want. Within the limits, as you can see in the definition here, within the limits of the law. The limits of the law means you cannot do something illegal on your land. Obviously, you cannot kill people, but you can also not send smoke to your neighbor land. You cannot throw like bad smell, or you cannot play loud music on your land. The right of ownership is perpetual, which means there is no period of time. If you own a land, if you own a car, if you own a computer, you will be the owner of such object forever. Even after your death, you will transfer this property to your heir. How can you become owner of property? There are different ways. The most common ways are contract, when you buy and you sell property. Succession, when someone dies and transfer the assets to you upon his or her death. Accretion. What is accretion? Accretion is a word which means everything which grows upon or below the grounds of the land becomes property of the owner of the land. Other ways, which are very important, occupancy. What is occupancy? Well, when you occupy some property which does not belong to anyone, you become the owner of such property. Like, for example, you see a street dog and you decide to take it. You become the owner of that dog. Or you see a nice flower and you can take it. Or you go fishing and you take the fish in the river. Also, all the recycling business is based on this rule of occupancy. You can take everything which is ownerless, which does not belong to anyone. Obviously, there are some limits. Whatever is forbidden by law or in violation of another person, right? Like, for example, I cannot go to the jungle, kill a tiger, and then use the tiger as a mat, as a carpet in my house. This would be against the law, because there are some species which cannot be killed. So there are some limits. But whatever is not against the law or against in violation of another person's rights, then you have the right to occupy. What are the essential elements? There must be possession. So you must take physical possession of the object. Like in my example of the dog, you see a dog in the street and you decide to take it and put it in your car. Must be movable property. Movable property means something that is not land, is not house, is not bridge. Then it is movable property and does not belong to anyone. Abandoned items, something that, for example, you can find in the bin, or something that you can find at the edge of the street that has been abandoned, the temple that you can find at the temple, the dog that you can find at the temple, for example. But it's not something that I find at your house, or something that I find in the hotel room. Obviously, these things have not been abandoned. Or if I find a wallet on the street, it doesn't mean that someone has decided to throw the wallet away. Someone may have lost it, and then I need to give it back to the owner. I can also become owner of particular property, which can be movable or immovable, through prescription, or as it is called in the US, adverse possession. Section 1382 of the Civil and Commercial Code states, when a person has for a period of 10 years for immovable property, or 5 years for movable property, peacefully and openly possess a property which belongs to someone else with intention to be the owner, he acquires ownership. So now pay attention. In this case, this is different from occupancy. Occupancy is, if you remember, ownerless property. For prescription, we have property which belongs to someone else. So you can see how important this section is. It gives you the right to take some property away from the owner and to make it yours. It gives you the right to take even immovable property, like a land, away from the owner and make it yours. How it can be applied? Well, my neighbor is my best friend in a condo, and he passed away. He was 95, he has no heirs, no family. I start using his condo unit with peacefully and openly. I did not murder my neighbor to take his apartment. Openly, I show everyone that I'm there with intention of being the owner. Then I become the owner of such property. Or another example, I'm growing the land. I'm growing some vegetables on my land. I am, let's say, in Isan. I grow my plot vegetables on my plot of land. Then I notice that my neighbor is never there. You are my neighbor, you never come, you live in Bangkok, you never work the land. Then I have the idea, I should grow vegetables on your plot of the land as well, so I can make more profit. And then little by little, I start growing vegetables there. 10 years, 15 years have passed, you don't notice anything. Well, after 10, 15 years, I become the owner of that plot of land. I just need to show evidence that I've been there for more than 10 years, peacefully and openly. There is no police report. And I must show the intention of being the owner of that land. What does it mean, the intention? Well, the intention doesn't mean that, you know, I really, really, really want it to be mine. Intention means I did not rent the land. You did not give me permission to use the land for free. I'm doing this against you. This is why in the US it is called adverse possession, because I'm doing this against the owner in order to take it something from him, from her. And as you can see, it's not written in the definition that prescription must be made in good faith. It can be made in bad faith. I know I'm not the owner. I know that plot of land is yours, but I still take it. Prescription. So There are four elements, as I just explained, for possession, for adverse possession. First, the property must belong to another person. I cannot do that with my own property, otherwise it doesn't make any sense. Second, open and peaceful possession. So it means that I take possession, I use your property as if it was my property. Must be visible, apparent. I'm not hiding under the ground, you know. I'm just there, I grow vegetables, or I take your apartment, I use the balcony, I make barbecue, I wash my clothes there. I make a swimming pool on your land. It means that he gives notice to the legal owner that someone is using it against her, against him. I can erect a fence around the land. I can make a building on your land. I can cultivate the land in any manner which is open and would be noticeable to the owner. Obviously, the owner can call the police before these 10 years. But if 10 years have passed and he didn't do anything, then it becomes my land. Possession must be 5 or 10 years. It depends. 5 years if it is immovable, 5 years if it is movable. As I told you, there must be also the intention to be the owner. What does it mean? It means that you possess the property as an owner, not as a lessee. Okay? And you hold it against anyone else who claimed the land. So you put a fence, you don't let anyone touching your property. It's yours, so you have the intention of holding the property just for yourself. This will create the right. Okay, so this is, as you can see in the book, the main rules which apply to ownership. So the first part of this lecture has been spent in defining what is ownership and how can you become owner. What are the legal ways for owning properties? Now we go to the second type of real right, which is called possession. What is possession? Possession is when you hold the property, when you use something with intention of using the property for yourself. You can find the definition under section 1367 of the Civil and Commercial Code. So it's a matter of fact. When, for example, you borrow a car, when, for example, you rent an apartment, you are the possessor of that apartment. You are not the owner of the apartment. So you can see that there must be two elements. First of all, the physical control. You can use the apartment, you can use the car anytime you want. So you have the power over the property to be there, to be on the sofa, to use the bathroom. This is the physical control of the apartment. And also the intention, attitude in the mind, of denying the rights to other people. When you use the car that you borrow, you lock the car before leaving. You don't let anyone else touching the car. And even when you rent an apartment, the fact that the apartment is not yours doesn't mean that you let whoever coming inside the apartment. Before you leave the house, before you leave your place, you will lock the door because you want to show your intention to be the only possessor of that particular property. And even if the owner will come, you will tell the owner you have no right of being here. The owner cannot be in your apartment without asking for permission. So possession is a matter of fact, is very easy. Many jurisdictions around the world, they don't even define possession as a real right. Is more a state of fact. Then we go to other real rights, and this is more difficult to understand because it's not so common. In Thailand, not so many people know what are the other types of real rights. This is why I recommend you to pay attention to the remaining four types of real rights. So the four types of real rights that we have are called servitude, habitation, superficies, and usufruct. Let's start with usufruct. What is usufruct? Usufruct is very similar to renting a place, but the usufruct gives a real, it's a real right. It's not a contract, it's a real right. An immovable property, this is the definition under the law, can be subject to usufruct, by virtue of which the usufructuary, who is the usufructuary, the person who lives, the person who uses the apartment, the house, the land, is entitled to possess, use, and enjoy the profit, the profits of the property. So basically, the usufructuary is exactly the same person as the owner, the same position, the same legal rights as the owner, except one: he does not own the property. So when we create the right of usufruct, the usufructuary can do everything he or she want to do with the property, except destroying the property. In which case, let's make an example, so maybe this can help clarifying what is usufruct. It happens often that foreigners, they come to Thailand, they find a Thai wife and they get married with a Thai lady. Then they may decide to buy a house, but foreigners, they cannot buy a house in Thailand. So they give the money to, they cannot own land. This is what the law says. So they give the money to the lady, and then the lady will buy the land and the house. This is very common in Thailand. However, the foreigner can be kicked out anytime. So one way to protect the legal situation, the legal position, would be to register usufruct. So the lady, the wife, is the real owner of the land and the house, but the husband would be the usufructuary, the person who can live and can use the house and the land until he dies. This is a good guarantee because it is a real right which will be registered at the back of the chanot, of the title deed. So basically, you will divide the ownership into two parts. One is the title deed, the name of the owner, which is the Thai wife. And then the person who can enjoy the property, can use the property, can possess the property for a period of time or until the end of his life, which is the foreign husband. So the right of usufruct may be established for a period of time up to 30 years, renewable only once for further 30 years, for the life of the usufructuary, or in case no period is fixed, it is for the life of the usufructuary. So you can see how important this real right can be. I make another example because you may say, okay, I'm not foreigner, you are not foreigner, you are Thai. How should I use this right of usufruct? Well, I make an example. Your mom or your dad, they may decide to transfer ownership of their house to you. They want to give the beautiful house they have bought to you. However, they may be scared that you eventually in the future, you may kick them out before they die. So they can say, you get the name in the chanot, you will be the new owner of the house, but we keep the right of usufruct. So they can write in the chanot that you are the owner, the new owner of the house, but they are the usufructuary and they have the right to use, possess, enjoy the house until they die. And you cannot even go there, eh? Because the right of the usufructuary means possess, use, and enjoy, which means they have the right to be in the house. The owner, although he is the owner, has no right of using, possessing, and enjoy the profits of the property. Okay? This is usufruct. Then we have servitude. What is servitude? Under section 1387, an immovable property can be subject to servitude, which means that the owner of property is bound for the property of another immovable property to suffer certain act affecting his land, or to refrain from exercising certain rights related to his ownership. What does it mean? This can be a bit confusing. I have here an example. Imagine that you are the owner of the land up the dominant tenement, the picture on the top. So there are two lands, one is up, the other one is down. There are two lands together. You are the owner of the land above. I am the owner, the servant tenement, the owner of the land below. Now what happened? It would be very convenient for you to cross my land in order to have access to the public road. It would make your life much easier because this is the fastest way you have to access the public road. So you can say, Alex, can I have an agreement with you? Can I register a right of servitude? This right will give you the right to cross my land in order to have access to the public road. If I accept, we go together to the land office and we will register the right of servitude upon the land. So we need to write on the back of the chanot that there is an agreement of servitude. So both your chanot and my chanot. Now, this agreement cannot be cancelled unless we have a new agreement between the parties, which means that even if there will be a new owner for your land, even if there will be a new owner for my land, the right of servitude has been registered already on the back of the title deed and cannot be changed unless there is a new agreement in the future. Okay, I told you servitude can be created to have access to the public road, but it can also be created to have access to the beach. Or for example, instead of making a way to go to public road, I can ask you, can I let the electricity cables crossing your land so I can have electricity, internet cables, water pipes, whatever it is, to make my life easier. Servitude may be created only for the benefits of the land. So this is why it will be registered on the back of the chanot. It's not for the individual. The land affected must be close to each other. Otherwise, there would be no point of making a servitude. And the servitude must provide some benefits to the neighboring land that we call dominant tenement. Real right of habitation. So I explained already what is usufruct, servitude. Now we go to habitation. What is habitation? Habitation is not very common in Thailand. Not so many people use this right of habitation, and it's not much important for business. It entitles the holder, the beneficiary, to live in a building has a residential purpose without paying the rent. So I can give you the right to live in my house. I give you a room of my house and you can live in this room until you die. It can be made for the life of the grantee, so until you die, or for a period of 30 years, which can be renewed once for further 30 years. So this is a right that usually we create when we want to reward someone. Like, for example, there is a maid who has been working for my family for 30 years. Now she's old. I decide to give a right of habitation and let her stay in my house until she dies. I don't want her to be homeless because she has been very nice to my family for a period of 30 years, now I give her a reward, I give her something back. I create a real right. I'm scared that when I will die, my children will kick her out. This is why I create the right of habitation. I don't just give my word, but I give the right of habitation, and I will register on the chanot, on the title deed, that she can stay until she dies. So my children, even if they want to kick her out, they cannot do that. And the last one is superficies. Superficies is also very important for business. Right of superficies is a property right which must be registered at the land office on the back of the title deed. It will separate ownership of the land and anything that is made on the land, which can be a building, a house, a structure, can be bungalow, can be plantations. So Why people do that? Well, let's say, for example, I have a big land, but I never use this land. You come to me and say, Alex, I have the idea of making a nice coffee shop, and I make a nice business there. I will clean your land, and I will make a very beautiful garden. Can you give me the right of superficies? I say, yes, I give you the right of superficies. You make the coffee shop, you make a beautiful playground, and we have the agreement that after 10 years, everything will go back to me. So your coffee shop and the playground is mine. So basically, it's a very good opportunity because I have coffee shop and playground without investing any money. And for you, it's good as well because you can make profits for a period of 10 years without even spending one baht for paying rent. So it can be good for you and can be good also for me. It can be made for a period of 30 years for the life of the owner of the land or for the life of the superficiary. In my example, the person who wants to make the coffee shop. So it can be very interesting because it separates ownership of the land and ownership of the coffee shop or any other structure, construction that you want to make upon the land. The right of superficies will be registered for a specific term of time and can be transferable and inheritable. So even if you die, the right of superficies and the right to run the business and run the coffee shop can go to your family member, to your children and everyone else. Okay, so this is the end of this presentation.